Oh, hello there. Welcome back to the Agostino Zynga Show with me, your host, Agostino Zynga. And this is episode number 394 of the Agostino Zynga Show. Thank you for tuning in once again. If it's your first time tuning in via YouTube, make sure you smash that like, hit subscribe, leave me a comment down below. And if you're listening via the podcast app, please leave me a 5-star review, download the show, and share it with all your family and friends. Why don't you help the kid out, do the thing, be involved in the click? And as per usual, if you want to support the show via Patreon, you're more than welcome to. There's a link down below in the show notes. Via Patreon, you get access to this show in full HD format before it comes out anywhere else, as well as access to my entire archive of previous shows, as well as one bonus episode per week available only for my Patreon backers. So make sure you jump on board. It's only $1, equivalent of £1, to jump on there. So make sure you get involved, unlock that Patreon only content, and start communicating with the little community that we're building on there. Get involved. Link can be found in the show notes as well as the show description. It's patreon.com/Agostino. If I don't fumble my words, it's patreon.com/Agostino, spelled A-G-O-S-T-I-N-H-O. Click the link, get involved, back the show. So here we are, back again. Yeah, back-to-back shows, not taking my foot off the pedal, going as hard as I can, because why not? If ever there's opportunity to go as hard as you can and work, because I'd assume a lot of people during this, you know, restricted living arrangement that we're in at the moment, I bet you're in a situation where, for the most part, I guess there's a lot of people who are working from home. And if you're working from home, it's pretty difficult to take a day off from working it, or to like call in quote unquote sick. It doesn't really happen, I'd assume. I'm assuming a lot of companies are, you know, secretly thankful that they're, you know, saving money on rent. Depends though, now I'd assume if you're having office in a city center somewhere, you probably sign leases that are, you know, more than 18 months long, so you've probably already put down a lot of money and the place is essentially going to waste without people in it. But let's imagine you pay month to month for 6 months, your lease is up, you don't have to pay the rent anymore, and you're also so saving money on that, you're saving money on having to, you know, buy snacks for the end of the week for your staff members and drinks, and you're also you also got like a far more motivated workforce, I'd say, because wherever I've worked, anywhere that I've worked, the correlation between the amount of people who are off sick continuously and also the amount of people that will quote unquote work from home was a direct correlation to how bad of a workplace and toxic it was. There was direct correlation. It just happened. There was maybe the one place I went at where I was at briefly where some of the working from home things were just genuine and the company were pretty good about letting people work from home in order to kind of balance their family life and blah blah blah. But for the most part, if people are calling in sick oftentimes in your company or a place that you work in, it's probably a good representation of just how poor the environment is there to work. But I assume during COVID, even the most toxic of workplaces, you can kind of get away from it. You can essentially unplug because you're at home, isn't it? It's quite difficult to unplug when you're at work and you're coming back and you want to recap your day. But when you're at home and you're working on a laptop, it's pretty difficult to start ranting and raving. It doesn't really make sense about stuff that's happened on the laptop. You just close it and continue doing your thing, right? I would assume so. I'm sure people are still moaning now and still gossiping and berating and just kind of chewing the ear off of their partner about some nobody person at work that they don't really like. But I think most people, I'd assume, are probably in the most happiest time that they've been at working in places. I'd assume so. For myself, it's no real change, you know. I've kind of secretly always wished that I could be in a situation that allowed me to work from home. It allows me to balance my schedule a lot better. So I'm a bit detached from it. I'm not, you know, it's unfair for me to kind of put myself in that scenario because I have some very controversial views on work. But I think most people would probably look at this time and period and think, you know what, this is such a blessing in disguise. And I'm assuming a lot of companies too, managers, founders, you know, executives are like thinking, yes, I've got a motivated workforce. I can call upon anybody at any time. People are more probably adept or more prone to maybe picking up calls outside of working hours as well. Imagine people are probably willing to pull in an all-nighter, especially working from home. Like, why not? It takes your mind off, you know, having to look after your bloody kids, isn't it? I'd assume so, or paying your partner some attention. It's a welcome distraction, isn't it? Talking to strangers or talking to quote-unquote people outside of your household. Because I remember reading somewhere that supposedly team morale in a lot of places has gone up via Zoom. And like, you know, Zoom was meant to be that scourge, because I remember prior to COVID, doing meetings on Zoom, especially with people that weren't in your office, was always annoying, or just were in different time zones, let's say. It was always kind of annoying, the lag, the connection, And just generally you lose a lot, you know, by not seeing somebody face to face. But having been in the physical space or vicinity of some people you work with in the office, and then seeing them via Zoom, seeing how they interact with their families, seeing the background of their rooms, shooting the shit about what they got up to in the weekend, it adds a different element. It allows you guys to be a lot more personal. There's a lot more humanity and understanding and benefit of doubt given in meetings. It's a lot less cutthroat. The meetings I've been in so far, everyone's kind of jovial and really happy to be there, sharing experiences, trying to help each other out. So I think, you know, it's been a net positive. Of course, we know that because, you know, Zoom's putting stock prices keep going up and through the roof. The founders made a bunch of money off the success of it. And, you know, by and large, no one's really touched Zoom or come close to, you know, challenging its position. There's an app called Mm-hmm. That's, yeah, don't get it confused. That is what the name of the app is. Mm-hmm. That's out at the moment. That's like M-H-H-M-H-A or something like that. One of them. That's sort of kind of trying to get involved in the live video conferencing sort of game. Skype has made a bit of a resurgence. I've seen a lot of people using Skype here and there during podcasts. You see a little Skype logo on the top left, but most of the time you're seeing people doing stuff via StreamYard. You know, of course, if you're streaming via YouTube and Twitch and stuff, but mostly conferencing has been done via Zoom and maybe the odd, you know, Discord video chat here and there. But I don't know. Interesting to see what happens when things open up, because, you know, we can talk blue in the face about what's happened with COVID, but I'm interested to see what happens on the other side. Does this continue? Do people maybe miss the office and think, you know what, I don't want to work at home anymore. Now I've got the opportunity to go back to the office. I'm going to work there completely. That might be a thing. I'm not too sure. It'll be interesting to see how that progresses going forward, but let's wait and see. I'd love to hear your opinions, actually. What do you guys think? Would you prefer to carry on working from home? Would you want to be back in your offices, heading out to lunch together with your other colleagues, meeting up with other people from other offices around the area for Friday drinks, Thursday drinks? Let me know in the comments below. I'd love to hear your thoughts regarding that. Anyway, jam-packed show to get into, loads of stuff to cover, loads of really interesting cultural tidbits here and there. So make sure you grab whatever drink you are sipping next to you, have a little drink or so, have a little nibble, because we're going to dive on deep straight away and get involved in some of the things that I found in the internet that I think of might be of interest. So I mentioned a couple times on here, based on other topics concerning dance music and club land and my love for nightlife, and, you know, just missing that whole part of my life, obviously due to the current situation in the world. And then I stumbled upon this article from Mixmag, which detailed Larry's Garage, which is a documentary about Larry Levine and Paradise Garage, a seminal New York club. Basically was, you know, the launching pad for a lot of really influential DJs in the scene, and a real good time capsule of an era in dance music that's sort of long forgotten, especially if you're looking at it through the prism of American dance music culture and what it's sort of kind of evolved into now with EDM. It's nice to have like a bit of a history lesson as to where the origins of that scene come from, and maybe a reminder as to the part of the part played by some of the more, you know, instrumental figures in that scene, the Black Latino people, especially people within the LGBTQ scene, the queer guys and girls who were at the forefront of pushing this really weird, interesting music during that seminal moment. And again, I have like a surface level understanding of Larry Levine's cultural relevance and how important he is to clubland, dance music, music in general, club culture, and whatever it may be. But I thought, why not give myself a refresh, especially with the clubs being closed, and try and watch the actual documentary. Unfortunately, the documentary itself, for some reason, was deleted or hidden behind a paywall. It was released as part of the ADE festival that's happening in Netherlands. They did like a kind of online festival, I guess, to, or video conference, whatever it is, to kind of obviously impart due to what's going on in the world with COVID. And they put the entire podcast documentary up on Vimeo for everyone to watch. And I watched, I think, half of it the other day, tried to rewatch the other half today, but unfortunately that won't be on the paywall. And again, it looks like a pretty decent documentary from the what I watched. There was really interesting rare tidbits of Larry Levine actually Larry Levan, sorry, talking directly to the camera about some of his inspiration behind the Paradise Garage, what went into making it such a seminal place, his approach to DJing, and just some really heady stuff that, of course, I'm a sucker for, being a DJ myself. It's great to see where the origins of this shit came from, especially somebody that looks like myself playing such a key and important role. Which then brought me neatly upon to this other documentary that came out in 2003 called Maestro, which is quite possibly, especially because I watched the entire thing, might be an entirely better documentary, but offers an entirely different perspective of what happened with Paradise Garage, because instead of just focusing on what Larry Levan done, it sort of focuses on the entire ecosystem around the club, what was his inspiration, some of the key figures that sort of sprung up from the Paradise Garage, the role it played in the entire community, and just generally kind of gave you a real appreciation for his influence on what he kind of done with that amazing club in New York. And I'm going to play a bit of the trailer for you here. Hopefully I don't get pulled from YouTube, but let's play anyway. Slow that a bit. Come on. Okay, there we go. It's playing now.
Me with bodyguards. And I said at one point, how close are you supposed to stand to me? He said to me, in other words, if you want toilet paper, I hand it to you.
They actually signed bodyguards to him to watch him, so the people, because they knew that this was going to happen, but it happened anyway.
And it was a big letdown.
So we weren't even permitted, and we still did it, and we still worked.
It was fun
because it was great. We were playing records. We were playing records.
People didn't know actually that we would probably paid them.
Yeah, we would have.
Probably.
Because it was the greatest experience to see people dance.
It was the beginning of the world of the DJ culture. A time when a group of people found refuge outside the mainstream.
Love music, garage music, has to be.
Frankie Knuckles speaking.
Are all one and the same, you know, because the loft set it all up, you know. The garage made it real, you know, and probably the warehouse solidified that, you know, in this culture.
New York City, 2 a.m.
I have to say that when I came to the loft, and me and George already going to the garage, we thought we were dancers, you know? I went to the loft and I was actually intimidated because the guys were doing like things that we never ever saw. And they were so different in their own way that you gave them as much respect that we couldn't even get on the floor, George and I. We wouldn't dare make a move because we were like, this is the real deal.
I feel about just honestly, it's quite possibly might be one of my most favorite documentaries I watch, especially concerning dance music, especially considering nightlife culture, club culture. A real eye-opening account. What did I learn from it? I learned obviously about Larry Levan's influence and cultural relevance, and the fact that his name still rings, you know, so many years after his untimely passing. Of course, this really deep reverence and respect he had for dance music, DJing, club culture, the fact that he kept going on and on and on about the bespoke sound system that they were going to install. Obviously, a lot of the inspiration came off the back of the stuff that David Mancuso did at the Loft, but there was this idea that what separated the good from the great clubs was the sound system, and you don't hear that often spoken about too often nowadays in club culture. Now, of course, that could be because, especially in London, there are so many restrictions in place in terms of how you know, long places can open, where they can open, noise pollution, council regulations, Tory governments, whatever is in place that's sort of holding back a lot of the creative expression. But there is a lack of real kind of emphasis put on the sound system. A lot of the current cultural conversation surrounding club culture is mostly focused on superstar DJs, the biggest name that you can get, who's got the, you know, the biggest following, who can sell the most tickets, and then, you know, basically, I guess the space may come second, and then maybe after that, the sound system. But mostly people are going out especially I've known, you know, people within my friendship group, people in the scene that I know locally, they're mostly going around following DJs. No matter where they play, they could play on a bloody barge somewhere, they'll go and follow them where they're playing. But there's a real lack of kind of appreciation of a real institute that has the best kind of sound system. And I guess, unfortunately, the places that did have some of the best sound system, I think of Matter, an old school venue here in London that was, you know, you had essentially speakers built in underneath the flipping ground, so the whole thing absolutely used to vibrate. These places are sort of far and few between. Most places just have like adequate enough sound systems to kind of get away with what they can get away with. I'd maybe say Fold in London's another good one that has a pretty decent sound system. XOY was a pretty good as well, considering that it's a bit of a commercial club, but there's less of emphasis on that, so that was great to see. I like this idea that he provided a safe space for queer, LGBTQ, Black and Latino community within New York. You can just imagine what that sort of machismo, gangster sort of street attitude must have been like towards gay people, especially during the late 70s, early 80s. Obviously super depressing to hear about so many people who passed away due to excessive drug use, and obviously AIDS during that time kind of tearing that cultural community apart. But I love the idea that prior to all that doom and gloom, he provided these people with an absolute safe haven that they could go to and dance and have a good time. They were sort of like, you know, some of the leaders in terms of having separate nights for separate crowds, a straight and a gay night. That was also really well done. I love the idea about memberships that they had in a nightclub. That was a pretty good idea.
So we weren't even permitted. And
there was a pretty good idea about memberships, and this is some of the membership cards that they sort of like gave to people that were obviously members at the place. They had to sign in to kind of guarantee that you had entry, kind of taking influence from, you know, private members clubs and really being picky about who entered those doors. And really going back to what I said in the previous podcast is about the best places are the ones that you necessarily aren't the most easiest to get into. And this sort of lends credence to it, even though this was a all-encompassing sort of like welcoming everybody, every color, race and creed, there was obviously some level of selection at the door which made the experience once you got on the dance floor that much richer. Do you know what I mean? And I really, really loved the care and attention that went into the cards, as well as the bespoke sound system and the people that played in behind the deck. I love that he had especially when you hear the accounts from other people who said Larry Levine wasn't the best DJ in the world, but he was one of the best selectors, in terms of not in like the corny, you know, Red Bull way that they kind of mention it, crate diggers and nonsense. He actually was one of the best people in terms of putting together a set list with some of the most eclectic, well-versed sounds out there. And I guess it reminds me a lot of sometimes of my love for DJ Harvey and why I think he's one of the best DJs in the world. Less about his kind of ability to mix and blend, and more so about the amount of curveballs that he throws when he's DJing. I've seen him play in Berghain, I've seen him play in Love Box, you know, I've seen him play in, you know, what was it, Ministry of Sound, and each experience has been completely catered and sort of like customized to the crowd. But he also was throwing up some real curveballs that really set the place on fire. And I guess he comes from that school, right? This idea that DJs aren't necessarily just kind of locked in on via their genre or via the clothes that they wear on their back. It feels like, especially nowadays in techno, if you wear a certain designer, right, if you wear Julius or Rick and stuff, there's a certain brand of music that you just have to play. You can't play anything bright and sunny with kind of colors, because essentially you are monochromatic. But it's cool to see that that was a thing back in the day, right? DJs being really colorful, representing all the colors in a rainbow, you know, no pun intended there with the LGBTQ flag. But that was really eye-opening. And again, just the aspect of like not accepting what you're given and sort of like carving out your own lane. They kind of, you know, made this amazing club, this amazing safe haven that, you know, didn't last for a long time, but the memories of that place live on, so much so that I'm talking about it now in 2020, right? And I watched a documentary that originally released in 2003, and there's another documentary that came out in 2020 that I'm obviously looking to be released soon, so hopefully someone from Ramp Production sees this. But look at the cultural relevance of such a place. And the issue that I have with a lot of the things that are happening nowadays in dance music, especially around the issues of race and inclusion and diversity, I do get the feeling that there's a lot of complaining going on and not a lot of doing. We all kind of are understanding of where the problems are. There are some really deep-rooted racial, structural power dynamic issues that would probably take a lifetime to kind of address or to rebalance. And I think the real power in dance music, the real power in nightlife, the real power in life in general is this idea, especially nowadays in 2020, because if they could do it back in the 70s and 80s, there really is no excuse for somebody to set up their own safe haven, their own agencies, their own management companies, production companies, lighting, security details, whatever it may be, right? Or just clubs in general, nightclubs, let's just say that, nightclubs in general that they can set up, not club nights in, you know, in already pre-built places that have their own leadership, who have their own idea of what, you know, a club night should look like, but make an actual club for yourself that actually caters to your demographic or caters to the people that you want to see dancing on your dance floor and make it one of the best clubs in the world. And I really do think there's appetite for it. If we're led to believe that there are scores of people that look like myself who are out there just gagging for an opportunity to get on the dance floor, to get behind the DJ booth and mix and do whatever they can do, then it really does lie upon people like myself and others who are maybe complaining about some of the lack of inclusion and diversity at some of these big places to go out there and actually make the change. And I think that's what I got away from watching Lo Levine and some of these people and some of his peers and people in the community and people that worked with him, or people that just idolized him from afar, speaking quite glowingly. And again, he was able to, in such a short amount of time, because he passed away, unfortunately, at the age of 38, he was able to leave such a cultural influence and impact in these people's lives, memories that sort of last for a lifetime, memories that these people so cherish, right? Is it Nicky Siana, right? An ex-boyfriend of Larry Levine was essentially still talking about him with such reverence. Those parts in the documentary where he had to kind of take a break. And, you know, because he was, you know, remembering some of the good times and he was close to crying. And, you know, how many years was it since he passed away in 2003 at the time? And it was still so raw for him. So I think that impact is something that people should maybe look to have in general. And again, I would much rather be the solution to this issue that's going on right now than just constantly complaining. And I think that's why I kind of took away from the Larry Levine story. And again, it's also a bit upsetting too, because, you know, America has such a rich history in dance music, and to see what it sort of devolved to nowadays, that's really distressing. Like, god damn it, what happened to America? Why did it suddenly go from being this amazing epicenter for some really creative, far out, very American but unique way of approaching dance music, to suddenly now they're in this place where they're kind of doing these really odd imitations of European dance music and club culture, which is really odd. I don't know why that happened. I have no idea. I don't have the knowledge for that. I don't have the brain capacity to understand why the club scene kind of went the way it went nowadays with EDM and, you know, the and whatever that nonsense is that gets played there in those clubs. But hey, what can you do, man? I really recommend you check it out. The documentary is called Maestro. It's available on YouTube. You can watch it there for free. I'm hoping that they release the other documentary that I want to watch, which is this one, called Larry Levine, the real story of the Larry's Garage, the real story of Larry Levine and the Paradise Garage. Hopefully that comes out later, but for now, if you want to check out a documentary, definitely check out Maestro 2003. That's what I watched. I thought it was a pretty brilliant watch for me. Next on the list, talking about people complaining, there's a really, really interesting and thought-provoking interview here, courtesy of Dweller, an electronic, let's just get the actual about page here so I can make sure that I'm not quoting them out of turn. This says here, Dweller Forever Writing from a Black Perspective. Dweller started in 2019 as an electronic music festival platform, electronic arts, and this is a derivative blog started in 2020 centering on the Black perspective, right? So you kind of get the gist on what they're doing. They're providing a safe space, a publication platform for artists within the dance music scene, especially I guess techno, and trying to boost the signal of some of the Black acts in there, because I guess, especially if you're looking from a European perspective, a lot of the media out there is a bit whitewashed in it. So there is an avenue, there is a space for this platform to exist, especially now with the conversations post George Floyd's passing. There's definitely an appetite for a more diverse platform that's providing, you know, that's highlighting some emerging acts or maybe some actual story that's maybe overlooked. But regardless, I like some of the articles, I like what they're talking about. But I think this article here, a conversation with LSD XOXO, the process of waiting to excel and the Black Techno Revolution, kind of triggered me in some way, shape or form, especially off the back of, you know, watching the Larry Levine documentary and what basically he was able to do during some really, really tough times in the 70s and 80s, to see people sitting here and essentially complaining about not being included, given the amount of resources that we have available and access and whatever it may be, is a little bit disingenuous. But again, who knows? Let's read some of the questions and answers, and then we'll kind of go through some of my opinions regarding it. Where is it? Where is it? It starts off somewhere here, I think, at the bottom. We got mixtape working on much. I've been working on my choreography. It continues here. Where is it? It gets really interesting towards here, the bottom. Yeah, so there we go. It gets around here. Okay, cool. So, so it says, yeah, Frankie, obviously one of the head honchos from Disc Woman, ask LSD XOXO the following question. I mean, it's crazy how much black artists in New York are putting out into the world. And he replies, it's just like a real resurgence in black dance music. It feels like because of the social climate right now, we actually have to take ownership of what's ours. White artists just really stepped into dance music and took over. Of course, there are some great white artists, and I'm thankful for what they contribute. But you have to understand, you're a guest, and we, as black people, have to understand that we're not necessarily the creators of everything, but even though we kind of are. But we know when the space is not ours. White producers and musicians don't really have that. They don't know when to grasp it. They're existing in a space that they did not create. I feel like now, because we've been able to speak up and share our experiences, it's becoming really exciting. Like, all the black artists I know are just being a lot more explorative with their music. And also, there's just no holds back. It's just like, we know the black people are the creators. We know our shit is good, and we don't have those fucking glass ceilings that we had before. Like, we have a lot more space to work with. Now, of course, you know, some of the tricking bits are this idea of sort of like scene or genre ownership is always a bit weird to me and always kind of not really sat right in my head. You hear a lot of people using that phrase about, you know, other races being guests within your set musical genre. Now, I know this kind of mindset exists everywhere. Reggaeton, which is ironic considering the name. Reggae music, country music, hip-hop, R&B, there is a certain thing where, like, if the prominent race of that genre see others outsiders coming in, there's obviously a bit of a pushback. That's completely understandable. But there is a part of me that's sort of disappointed that happens in dance music, especially when you think of the sort of unifying nature of clubs and dance floor and music in general, right? Especially when you consider the amount of references and genres that dance music pulls from, you would hope that there would be a bit more unity and a bit more of a kind of raceless perspective when it comes to dancing on the dance floor. But of course, I know life is more complicated than that. It all can't just be this, you know, raceless utopia where we don't see color. But, you know, that's something to kind of stipulate and kind of throw out there as a kind of prerequisite to sort of set the tone of for the entire conversation. And it continues here, Frankie asks, I mean, it's really thinking about now about the amount of glass ceiling black artists face. And he replies, everyone in music is just like a gatekeeper. It's like the cool thing to be is a gatekeeper. Why has it become so cool for music to be like this elitist thing? It's because everyone who's running it is a white person. Pretty much every genre of dance music has created a political movement as a way to get you to step away from colonialism, capitalism, and now those have become the deciding factors. Like, what's hot in dance music? Where are the opportunities at? Of there's an element of gatekeeping in any industry. I think that's where innovation and creativity comes from. I think if you're not facing some level of opposition and some level of pushback in the genre or area that you want to pursue, it probably isn't worth pursuing. So I wouldn't really read too much into that. And again, there is a part of me that also thinks the barrier of entry in dance music is extremely low. As long as you've got the money, as long as you've got the access to the venues and equipment, you can effectively put on a party just about anywhere, especially if you've got the audience and the customers or the community willing and able to travel and pay to attend your events. You can kind of cultivate your own little scene pretty quickly. It continues here. oh, it says, yeah, European second, and then says of LSTP is following. This is the, it's the main culprit about European, the touring circuit. Yeah, since I've moved here in Europe, of course, like, of course, I realize that the glass ceilings and stuff that happens to the States, but I've grown to appreciate the States so much because, like, there's just a natural sense to me more vocal and talk about things that are opposed to just trying to skirt around everything. Yeah, they don't like to conflict, so they can't resolve anything, which is true. I do think there's an aspect of, like, avoiding the tough conversations. I think in the UK we have this issue even here with the lack of, I guess, yeah, with the weird way that we kind of approach door picking, right? You go to, I think I mentioned it previously, you go to a club in Brick Lane and you're a group of five lads, doesn't matter what color or race you are, probably might be increase your chances if you happen to be white and wear skinny jeans and say, all right, mate, and your, you know, sleeves are, you know, your arms are covered in sleeve tattoos. But for the most part, it's pretty difficult for a group of boys to get into most clubs within, I'd say, central London towards the central east central sort of area, right up until Dawson. It's really difficult. Most places I've got this set my idea in the head that groups of boys are just gonna immediately cause trouble, so there's discrimination that way. And there is also this weird sort of thing where there's a lot of segregation in terms of, like, scenes, the hipster scene, the commercial scene, the tech house scene, the this scene, the underground scene, the warehouse scene. There's a lot of real, there's lack of kind of blending of the communities, especially when you consider the punters that go are generally sort of going for the same sort of thing, right? Dance, get high, get drunk, meet new people. But there is a lot of kind of separation in that regard. And some of it is manufactured, or some of it is sort of orchestrated or architect by the industry itself, right? Right, this prevalence to maybe push out certain voices, push out certain people, push out certain faces, certain colors and creeds. But again, I think even though it could, there can be a lot of sort of barriers, I do think the opportunity is also the fact that you can essentially, as long as you can sell tickets, as long as you can, you know, get a lot of people to spend money behind the bar, you can essentially put on your own thing and sort of avoid all the issues that exist out there in clubland. But it, you know, but you then end up creating the same kind of clique that you're sort of running away from. But hey, what can you do? It continues. She says this. Cranky says it's quite hostile, actually. He says, yep. I've had blowouts with people here in Europe. Of course, he mentioned in Berlin, I think, because he lives there. He said, I've gotten into it with so many of the people that I worked with in the past in Berlin, because you have to teach them how to work with black artists, how to work with an artist that's not come from their same background. That's an extremely broad, generalized statement. But again, you know, this is what you're going through personally, so I can't object to it. He says, you have to respect the art that comes along with it. It's not just about bureaucracy and business. I respect both sides of music as well, but if you're just focusing on that stuff, it's just like, where's the meat? Where's the fucking meat? I don't even eat meat, but I want it in the music. He says, living in Berlin has been a definite hassle for me, but the time has come to move here was a good time, because, like, I actually feel like I had some sort of say in the things. I had my power just because people know who I am, and from the last release, I'm able to utilize that so I can get my foot in the door. So I'm trying to get my body in the door so I can hold it open for other black artists, which is great. That's what you want to see. And again, you know, living in Berlin, I guess you have access to some of the best, or maybe well-connected agencies out there, some of the best venues, people that really care about the music. And as long as you have the right support system around you, there is an opportunity for you to kind of reach a wider audience and ultimately get to a level where you can sustain yourself as an artist. Because I think there is obviously a lot of, there are people who come into dance music, especially DJing, wanting to sort of, you know, conquer it all and be the person with the most list of gigs on RA and be well regarded, win awards and whatever it may be. But most people, I'd assume, myself included, you get into it because you just want the respect of your peers. You want to be able to command a decent amount of following, a decent enough of a following, and also just have a career where you're not able, where you're not kind of having to be put in a position where you have to work a part-time job. If you're able, those needs are able to be met, you're going to be pretty happy, I'd assume, especially, you know, you sprinkle in some collaborations and remix work with people that you actually love and rate, maybe an opportunity to maybe bring up or kind of help some other kids come through. Like, that's basically what you want. And if that's the case, Berlin is definitely the great place for that to happen. Of course, there's going to be the other side of the coin where there's going to be a lot of, you know, opportunistic, social climbing heads. But I think all in all, from the times I've been there, and especially, you know, I'm not somebody that's well connected. I'm just a raver and a DJ who just happens, you know, to go to Berlin like every year to have a bit of a dance, I found it a pretty easy place to kind of make some connections. And I've only spent, you know, the best part of what, of a couple of weekends there every other year or so. So I can imagine living there, the opportunities and the doors that are open can be amazing. It continues. He says here, Frankie says here, these clubs need to keep their doors open, which is funny. He replies and says, the clubs in Berlin, they love a queue and they love a closed door. I'm not shitting on Berlin. I've had a lot of opportunity here because the government actually does respect artists and respects what we contribute to society. In America, the artists are looked down on and we don't provide anything. It's a bit self-explanatory there. It continues, says, but it's also like what the people think they listen to and watch. People are consuming art and constantly. Where's the other thing I was going to say here? I think that was interesting. Let's skip along here. Where is it? So Frankie says the following. He says, I mean, it's really weird, and it's like we really have to just be treated like fucking shit all this time, and it's like a crime, honestly. LSD replies, it helps you to realize this. Not only have we been treated like shit, we've been given the shit end of the stick constantly, and really in a space, in a genre that we created, and also how unbothered they are by everything. It takes the piss. We've gone through so many struggles this year as people, and I just watched the people I've associated myself in this past year, and a lot of them are so oblivious to the issues outside of their own bubble, which I can understand why that can be frustrating, for sure, especially if you're more politically and socially active than some of your peers, trying to bring up some conversations. Because most of the time as well, there is a little bit of a difference, I think, in Europe than there is maybe with America. There is a reluctance to talk about politics openly, especially hot button topics like race, discrimination, social and economic inequality. It's just not things that you just casually bring up, and it's always going to cause a little bit of a rift, you know. Whereas in America, you do get the feeling that it's sort of like fire from the hip a lot more often, especially, you know, in a Trump presidency world. There is maybe a bit more of an onus put upon, you know, sharing your opinion and making sure the people you're speaking to know that you're not voting for the orange man bad. But again, I would say that experience probably is true and it's probably distressing, but I would say there is a real opportunity for people like Frankie and LSD to maybe lead the light and, you know, take some of these experiences and sort of use them as an opportunity to provide a space and a safe haven for artists and people that they want to represent, especially in a place like Berlin, right? You would assume, especially with the amount of people outside of the mainstream doing the underground scene out there who are really pushing things forward. You look at, there's this channel called Widows Collective that I follow online on YouTube that does some really interesting streams of some underground artists that you probably haven't heard about, so definitely check them out. Obviously they got the HOER, I don't know if you pronounce it Hoer or Hoa, however you pronounce that word. They have one of the probably the best online DJing, you know, radio stations that exist out there in Berlin, pushing out some really amazing people. They book anyone from Ellen Alien to, you know, somebody that you haven't heard of from the local scene. So there are opportunities, and it really is a shame that there isn't a space specifically out there in Berlin that's catering towards representing voices that aren't necessarily represented some of the bigger clubs. That's the issue that I think in that regard. And I think she makes a good point of it here, actually, Frankie, about Berghain, that I was actually thinking. Let me see if I can get it here. Berghain, see if I can find it. Where is it? Oh, maybe she took it away. Names, it is. Naming names. See, where is it? Yeah, there you go. So, okay, she changed. Maybe she didn't write the name properly, but there's a question here. She makes a good point, right? So, you say, so Frankie says, do you think Berghain is going to come back swinging with an all black lineup? Which is something I've sort of thought about a lot, especially during post, you know, lockdown. Also, during post COVID, during post George Floyd's passing, it kind of, you know, brought us some very interesting conversations around representation, discrimination, blah blah blah, in various industries. And I do think there's an opportunity, especially for a place like Berghain, to maybe lead the charge and sort of set an example. Unfortunately, dance music, like a lot of industries, is a bit me too and copycatty. So as long as one person is setting the tempo and sort of showing you how things can be done, other places can do the same thing. You know, the whole sticker on the phone, the whole no pictures on the dance floor, the whole providing a safe space for queer LGBTQ folk, Bergheim sort of at the forefront of doing that, and other clubs around the world sort of take some of the lessons learned and sort of outlined in their club and apply it to where they are. So the hope is if Bergheim come out and say, hey, we're going to just set example and we're going to commit to having a couple of nights a week be specifically for black and, you know, brown DJs or people that kind of aren't necessarily fall into the box of just being the commercial run-of-the-mill people that you'd see on an Awakenings lineup, I think that'll go a long way. Now, for me personally, would I necessarily like being booked under the premise that I'm only there because I fill in a certain racial quota? Probably not. But if that's an opportunity for you to get your voice out there and provide you the platform to amplify your message and provide your sound, then so be it, especially when it's an institution like Bergheim, right? You can kind of put a little bit of the cringe classification of yourself to one side in the hopes that your career can get the boost that's needed. Now, if you're a white artist and you haven't got any looks at any place, because again, I think a lot of those things have to do with network. I remember listening to an interview on DJs and Beers recently. I forgot who the guy's name is. He's one of the recent episodes where he was essentially talking about an incident that happened a few years back, maybe more than a few years back, with Richie Horton. Supposedly got banned from Bergheim for a set period of time because he got a little bit too leery behind the DJ booth. And that's when I found out, as opposed to in the Bergheim, there's a rule where if you're playing, you're not meant to have anybody. No, if you're not playing, you shouldn't be behind a DJ booth, basically. It's sort of to eliminate, it's the complete opposite of the whole DC 10 Ibiza crowd thing, right? There's always a cohort of hangers-on in the DJ booth trying to look important. But Bergheim are like, hey, if you're not playing, you can't be behind a booth. I guess this guy and Richie Horton are there. Richie Horton's playing before him. Richie Horton stays for the other guy's set. And I guess they get a bit rowdy behind their back. They have a few too many shots and things get a little bit leery. And Bergheim staff and the higher ups don't like it. So they ban both people. So much so that that guy, still from one of the guy that played after Richie Horton, hasn't played in Bergheim since that date, right? Of course, he mentioned that the booker at the time who booked him has moved on and they've got somebody else in place, and they obviously have their own favorites and their own people that they recommend. But even that dude who's, you know, as white as they come, he's never played in Bergheim again. So I wonder how someone like that would feel when they see a lineup that is essentially catered to people mostly based on the number one criteria being the color of their skin and less so about their ability to DJ and command the crowd and, you know, make them dance, all that good stuff. So that's where the issues come in. Now, again, is that short-term pain for long-term? Is that short-term, what's that thing called? What do you say? Short-term conflict for like long-term gain? Yeah, but you can see where the issues arise. But LSD's reply here is really interesting. It says the following. He says, I mean, if we're saying names, I feel like white-owned clubs haven't established themselves as institutions, just have their power that really can't be infiltrated. And so, even after all these conversations have been had, they're only going to be held to so much accountability. And therefore, if they're not actually being held accountable, they're not going to change. And if they can continue to have these all-white lineups and still make hundreds of thousands of bucks, they're going to do that. I'm pretty sure they're talking about Awakenings again because they're kind of, you know, known for that. Why would they want to fuck with the formula? I'm sorry, but I just don't think they care enough. Like, you don't care enough. That's just it. You need to leave black people working in all these places because you need somebody who's going to care. That I can understand the need to have maybe more black voices in there, but much like the conversation going on at the moment with Anna Wintour at Vogue, there is a part of me that thinks, especially again after watching this Larry Levine documentary about the Paradise Garage, I really wish a lot of this conversation was steered towards a productivity in terms of, hey, we're going to provide a solution for some of these pushbacks and barriers and obstacles that we face throughout our entire career in dance music, and just go and create your own club that kind of addresses all these injustices. And I think if this issue is something that's poignant and a lot of people have been feeling it, it'll be absolutely booming. Can you imagine what it would look like if they set up a nightclub in Berlin that was essentially highlighting some of these voices that aren't represented in some of the bigger lineups out there? Imagine what that would look like. Imagine what the clubbing landscape would look like in 5-10 years when that place is established and they've gained a little bit of notoriety. That would go a long way in terms of changing the entire patina, the entire color schemes of festivals and where you go out. And it doesn't take much. I know for myself, like, you know, I was somebody that was very much against the whole 50-50 gender splits on lineup, but you have to be honest, when you go to a festival or a party or a nightclub that has a lineup where they specifically cater, where they specifically make sure the lineup is, evenly balanced. There is a different ambiance, a different feel when you know somebody behind a booth isn't the typical bro playing for his bros behind the decks or playing for his bros standing next to a speaker. There's a different feel. Having those different voices definitely adds to the overall depth and texture of a night. And again, would you rather your nights be representative of the people on the dance floor or just representative of the stuff that only you listen to? For me personally, I want to be representative of the people on the dance floor, people that actually back what I'm doing. And again, I'd love to be a little bit more of a progression in the conversation, because these issues, we know they are there, but where are the solutions? Where are the people coming up and making their own things? I always, and I still maintain, I have this plan and this goal in my head, of kind of long-term goal of opening up my own space and my own club where I can kind of essentially provide a space for my friends and from the sound that I like to be basically promoted. But I wouldn't want to necessarily be told to book. No, I wouldn't want to be forced into booking people that I don't want to book just because it doesn't, just because it, the people that are pushing for it feel as if I'm not addressing their needs. I think a club should be kind of led by a voice, a scene, a tone, or whatever it may be, and it should sort of kind of address and maybe cater towards a different, you know, a set that demographic, a set community. But then again, if you don't like that set community, what you then go and do is set up your own club nights or set up your own label, set up your own whatever party series, and try and push those people forward. And then obviously the hope is people like myself that would have the club will be like, oh, that what you're doing is pretty good, let me insert just what I'm doing and go from there. But kind of going into establishments or institutions and sort of forcing them to bend a knee and to kind of acquiesce to your demands and to kind of represent the music that you want isn't necessarily the most productive way to go about it. I don't think that kind of leads to compliance as you go in there pointing fingers and telling people, hey, you gotta do that, whatever. It needs to be a bit more of cooperation. And again, if the cooperation doesn't work, you just go out there and you make your own. But regardless, I think it's a good article, a pretty good thought-provoking one, generate a lot of conversation, and hopefully lead to some actual solutions that a lot of us, you know, myself included, punters can benefit from. But definitely check it out. It's on Dweller Electronics. It's called In Conversation with LSDXOXO, The Process of Waiting to Excel, which is out now. His mixtapes, so definitely check that out. And The Black Techno Revolution. I'll put the link in the show notes. Next on the list, what do we have here? Oh, we have an update regarding that rave that I mentioned, right? So I guess The Independent have reported, and supposedly this rave was in Barking. Remember the one that said about the plague raves and whatever? Obviously, there's a issue at the moment going on with plague raves. No one likes these things. People throwing events during, you know, a global pandemic is a little bit irresponsible, right, to say the least. But like I mentioned in the other videos, I'm also understanding that there are people out there who genuinely are missing out on a large part of their sort of mental and emotional well-being by not being able to dance next to sweaty people and listen to bass heavy music and throw their hands up in the air and do copious amounts of ketamine, MDMA, and whatever else they can shove up their nose and put into whatever other holes they have in their body. So if that's the case, and you know, we know what we know about the virus and we know how to keep ourselves safe, it's to be expected that some people are just going to skirt the rules and just not give a shit. And I would much rather concentrate my time on the people that are caring and people that are not. There's nothing that you can do to change their opinion about things. I think those people that go to some events have sort of firmly are maybe falling that kind of, oh, it's a hoax thing, or it's not that big of a deal. So wasting your time getting irate about their actions isn't necessarily productive, isn't going to make any sort of change. But it's fun to just watch them from afar and see how many people kind of get triggered from it. And again, obviously you don't want anybody to die off the back of this, but I think people are being irresponsible going to Morrison's. So for me to expect people that go to illegal rave to be more responsible than them is really a bit far-fetched. So it goes, article from The Independent, 100-pack illegal London warehouse rave. It says a following here. It says hundreds have been caught on camera ignoring social distancing rules as they pack inside a warehouse for an illegal rave in London. Video footage shows maskless revers crammed together as they dance in front of a live DJ with a little regard to social restrictions. The recording shared on social media is said to be filmed at a rave in Barking, East London on Saturday night, which, considering the landscape of clubland in London Pacific, especially in the East, it was a pretty smart idea to go to Barking. Barking is a fairly desolate and dead place in East London, which, you know, it's a bit of a stretch to say it's East London. You could probably say it's its own little place. It's like a version of Florida within East London. They kind of beat to the sound of their own drum, but there's not much going on in Barking. So to throw a rave out there in the middle of sort of nowhere and kind of keep it under wraps, which it was for the most part, I heard no noise about it. Again, I'm not as plugged in as I was previously. I'm not necessarily going out in these sort of crowds. I wouldn't have known, but I only found out about it via the kind of social media content that was put out over the weekend regarding it. It continues, so the capital is currently in under tier 2 restrictions, which bans households from mixing indoors amid the rising COVID-19 cases. It continues to say business Teshno, the obviously Instagram page, posted footage of the event on Facebook on Sunday, describing it as a plague rave and tagging in three DJs. The Rave Vault account also shared a video on Twitter and Instagram with a caption, London's at it again, but later made the accounts private, which again is what I said previously, isn't it? What is wrong with these people? Because these business techno tech house kind of crew of people are very much social media first, right? They're less all about the look and the feel and the kind of moments where they're sort of dancing around the deck and doing that sort of handout thing and leaning back and forth on the mixer. They just can't resist having some footage of them playing somewhere, especially during a global pandemic, because they know it's going to get a mass amount of shares. It's going to trigger people online and it's essentially going to boost their profile in some way, shape or form. But in the long run, it's hurting them, isn't it? Because now they've got a spotlight on them. People are going to scrutinize their every move a lot more. Again, it's hard to try to re-educate. It's hard to implement practices like, you know, covering the phone camera on people's phones, especially in the UK. We don't necessarily have that culture, right? Where people take, you know, people take pictures in with the full flash on in nightclubs, right? Every 2 seconds. So to get them to not take a picture or a video of the first rave they've been to in nearly a year, it's just not going to happen. So that was to be expected. It continues. It says the recordings have divided opinion, with some backing the event organizers and attendees and others branding them irresponsible and COVID idiots. Matthew Bolter tweeted, "What did you expect by telling people you can't sing or dance?" Which is very much true. And while others said the industry was on its knees and being choked beyond repair and that people need a release after months of lockdown, which is also true. That's a thing that's happening here. People are unable to accept both ideas. You can accept that it's dangerous, irresponsible, and downright unpatriotic, or, you know, the opposite of civic duty to go out and party during this time, especially considering the amount of damage and long-lasting damage it can do to the overall health of the nation. But there's also an understanding that if this is to be expected, that during such a stressful and stressful and uncertain times, people are just going to go to the thing that they know brings them the most joy, the thing that is easiest to kind of unplug from, and it's a rave. It's that kind of thing, isn't it? That's what we know. That's what we kind of all go to parties for. I know in my experience anyway. It continues, while others said house music duo Solardo also weighed into the debate, tweeting the day after the event, "Rave should not be illegal." DJ and producer Justa Silva hit back, saying, "To promote plague raves is just effing irresponsible and grotesquely narcissistic." Again, that's what it is, isn't it? What do you expect? In a separate incident, police in Brighton also shut down a rave involved. But yeah, we shouldn't be surprised, isn't it? Like, it's a tech house lot, isn't it? What did you expect? They are narcissists to the core. Most DJs are anyway in most scenes. Let's not be kind of picking out those guys, but it's interesting to see the kind of reaction to it. Now, obviously, when it's people that some of these people like, that, you know, the attention and the kind of vitriol and the venom that comes towards the DJs is a bit different. It's easier to kind of point fingers and decry these people on social because you hate what they play and you hate what they represent. But the moment it's their friends, and, you know, there was a certain party in London with a few NTS regulars on there on the lineup, and no one had anything to say about that. So it's interesting to see how this will develop once COVID heads into the new year and the middle of next year, and there's still no events, and those same people are really in need of the coin to pay their rent. I wonder if the same people complaining online will be complaining. Anyway, moving on, we have, of course, I'm sure most of you are aware that Joe Rogan finally got a chance to sit down and interview Kanye fucking West. Long time coming. Especially for fans of the podcast, you would have known that there was a conversation around Joe Rogan interviewing Kanye maybe sometime last year. there was a lot of ups and downs, you know, in terms of that happening. You know, obviously Kanye having one of his many mental breakthroughs, he calls them, not breakdowns. And of course, you know, there was a question whether or not he would go on the show, having recently converted to Christianity and all this, or recommit his life to Christ, blah, 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 blah. But eventually they kind of sorted out, especially off the back of Jamie testing positive for COVID-19. There was also a kind of idea that, oh, they're going to push it back indefinitely, but they managed to make it work. Joe Rogan managed to kind of rope in Brian Redband, the original producer for the Joe Rogan podcast, or Joe Rogan Experience, sorry, and got Kanye West in for a pretty in-depth 3-hour conversation that I thought was pretty interesting. It might have been possibly the best Kanye interview I've seen in recent years, especially when you consider some of the more crazier interviews he's had. You know, the ones that come to mind are obviously the TMZ ones, but he was lucid, clear-minded. He looks great, looks really healthy, looks like he lost a bunch of weight as well. He looks like he's in a much better place mentally. I'm sure the success of Yeezy has definitely helped in that regard. He's having fun with his presidency, and seems like, even though there are bits in the interview where he quite clearly is giving the impression that he's taking this run for presidency very, very seriously, but it's also mostly an exercise of him to illustrate that nothing is impossible, that he can achieve and try and push most things as he's done in his career. But I think overall, again, as a fan of Kanye and what he's produced over the years, it is interesting to see, to kind of wrangle with myself about the lack of interest that I have in him as a person in general. I watched the interview because it's Kanye West, he's box office, and I want to see what some of the bants would be about, and maybe see some, you know, maybe catch some gems here and there. But in terms of caring about what he does and, you know, following his every move, my interest has really waned over the years. I'm not sure it's because I've just grown up, or because he's just demonstrated over time and time again that he can be a bit of an idiot in some places. You know, I think a lot of the stuff that really turned me off, especially during the, I don't care who he votes for, you know, he can do what he wants, but this kind of persistent stance that he had against intellectualism and not wanting to rest, not wanting to not wanting to try to articulate himself the best possible way or read up on a subject and just going with his first thought, was something that really kind of bothered me. The fact that he was maybe using his influence and his notoriety in a real self-serving way, maybe more so than he was in the past. Someone could argue that, hey, he's always been self-serving, narcissistic, but he was a bit more clever about his approach, and he kind of made it seem as if we as fans were all sort of in it together with him, and he was kind of doing this for us kind of thing. But now it quite clearly seems, especially since his marriage with Kim Kardashian, that it's all about Kanye, even sometimes to the detriment of his own family, right? He sometimes can say some things about his kids that you kind of think, whoa, mate, you probably don't want to talk about this in public. But again, as long as the attention's on him, all is good. So it's been hard to, you know, follow him and be a fan of what he's about. But in terms of creating products and, you know, just being a master of marketing, you definitely need to kind of pay attention to what he does, because there's no one operating on his level that does what he does. So that's something you can definitely take away from it. And there are some clips and bits stuff here that I've sort of found on social that were full of main interest. There's actually a breakdown here, someone uploaded on Twitter, of most of the topics that he spoke about, minute by minute. What was the thing that I liked the most on here? The music industry conversations were really interesting. Again, there's a lot of self-servingness in there, especially when you consider the issues that are sort of in the background regarding Big Sean's contract and the lack of masters that he's been given back, and the fact that he's owed money from Kanye that he hasn't been paid, blah, 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 blah. He spoke a lot about money, like a lot, and it's making me believe that most, you know, there was this understanding, I guess, if you're Kanye and you've always been doubted from the minute you entered the music all the way until fashion and streetwear, no, fashion and footwear and whatever he's doing now, he's always been met with some kind of resistance and pushback. It would make sense why he would be so adamant to mention at every moment that he's a millionaire, that he's a billionaire, that he got out of debt, that he's rich, that he's got money, he's got access. Because I guess those things are kind of, what did Elon Musk say? Elon Musk said something about vector. What was it? Attack vectors, right? Yeah. When Elon Musk was on Joe Rogan, he mentioned something along the lines, I think Joe Rogan asked him, oh, why doesn't he have like nice things, I don't know, like a massive house and all these other things, right? Like trappings of a rich person. And you remember Elon Musk saying those were like attack vectors, like people already, you know, find reasons to hate Elon, so he doesn't need to give them any more ammunition and give them vectors to attack him with by, you know, going out there and spending conspicuously on mad things. So I think maybe with Kanye, with the money, maybe for him, money is the opposite of that. And it's sort of like a defense vector because you can never question or push back on his ideas because he's demonstrated in every field that he's basically attacked that he can master it and kind of, you know, and get to the absolute apex of it and command a real high, you know, share price value and introduction, whatever it may be, because he mentions in the podcast about how the share price of Gap went up whenever he mentioned when there was announced that he's collaborated with them, blah, 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 blah. So that was something that kind of, you know, was a bit unsettling, you know, because, you know, Kanye is meant to be the creative inspiration, motivation guy, but to have him constantly mention money was a bit upsetting. But again, I get where he's coming from. Tesla Edison conversation was good. There's an issue with something about Black History Month and abortions was a bit spicy. Said something along the lines of, oh, black abortions are essentially genocide, which was the most Kanye thing I've ever heard in my life. That was interesting to see. I love these comments regarding Star Wars and basically the modern interpretation of Star Wars is complete dog shit, which echoes a lot of the stuff that you hear people online, some of the fandom menace, right, speak about on social. And a lot of the people involved with Disney Star Wars will go out there and say, oh, the fans are toxic and they create a bad atmosphere for the movies that they make. And now to have somebody of Kanye West level saying that essentially the modern incarnation, the modern, you know, product of Star Wars is completely devoid of some of the magic that existed in George Lucas's era was nice to hear. I'm sure some of the Star Wars fans out there were happy that he mentioned that. And of course, the shoe design bits and pieces. But let's go on some of the clips that I thought were of interest. Oh, not that one. This one. Kanye West explains his mindset. Let's click that.
So with this, and I love giving you guys my riffs. I'm like a human version of Instagram. When you look at Instagram, you look at, you know, you're looking like a 100 images a day. Well, I've got millions of images in my mind, and the majority of them haven't been realized yet.
I say he's more so a human representation of Google Chrome. You know, you've got like a million tabs open. Well, like I have anyway, I've got probably like 6 tabs in my blocking tasks, but that's probably what he's like. But anyway, let's continue on. Kanye West is building a 120,000 person stage in Atlanta, which I thought was a pretty cool idea that he mentioned too.
In the past couple months, have been going to Atlanta for 2 days a week or 3 days a week because I'm building this 120,000. I'm not supposed to say that I'm building. We're building a soundstage, but
like it sounds like an amphitheater, something that you would imagine would existed during the Roman Empire, right? This amazing cavernous structure that was designed in a way that really maximized the acoustics. I think he mentions it so that the roaring chorusy harmony vibe of the choir will just reverberate around the entire arena. That would be pretty cool to see. Again, will it be actualized during COVID? We never know, but I thought that was cool. Another one he mentions about the $20 foam runners that he's making with Yeezy, which I think are an incredible, incredible, incredible shoe. Most people hate them, but I'm a big fan of that shoe.
So for me, you know, I'm going to make this shoe be $20. And, you know, money isn't real, so that means the world should be eventually free. So I'm going to manifest the world being free. My dad, he lives in a DR, and he says, you know, anything that you put in the ground grows, so why do people still go hungry? And I like that in theory, but I was like, man, farming is really hard though, man. I think, you know, I might go hungry if I have someone to farm this food. It's like, but you know, back in the days we had that skill set. Now we're losing these skill sets that actually we can sustain off of. So with this, and I love giving you guys my riffs.
And I think he mentions earlier in the interview that supposed to be the foam runners completely manufactured in the States too. So that obviously there's the ability to ramp up and ramp down or ramp up and wind down production based on basically the demand. So that I thought that was pretty interesting as well. And then I think that might be it for the clips. What else is here? And then we have here a clip of Kanye explaining the missing Bannister theory.
Every kid loves to draw.
Yeah.
Right. But some people got to grow up, and like right. The artists.
Right.
In some way don't have to.
Yes.
Like this separate, we're all children. We're all, if you're alive, you're a child. We're all children in God's eyes, and we're all young people. Like Jesus is a old person. Like he's old. Like, you know, like Adam is old. You know, if you're alive, you're young, and we're like children. Mm. And there's all these things, these sharp edges, these corners, these anxieties, these fears, these things put in our food, our diet of what we consume right here that turn us old and make us brittle and make us put that fear on our kids. Don't you put that evil on me, Ricky Bobby. They put that. We put these evils on our children. We put racism on our children. We put fear on our children. And the children are fearless. The children... It's funny. It's like Claudio Silvestri, one of our lead architects that I work with since age 24. He built this home in Mallorca with John Paulson, and he has like this golf course, which it's in, the acoustics are incredible, but it's this part where you can walk along that's 20 feet high. And I said, you know, would you, you know, what about the kids? What, you know, you have a balcony, you have a banister or something? And he looked at me and said, they're smarter than we think.
Wow.
And meaning like, if we were never taught the missing banister theory, that we could all tightrope walk.
Mm.
The missing banister theory, I wrote it in my book, Thank You and You're Welcome, that I wrote with my friend Sakaya, that's actually here right now, that's that you were talking to earlier, is, look, you could walk down a straight line without worrying about anything, but you take that exact straight line and put it 20 stories high,
mm-hmm.
you know I'm going with it,
yep.
And you remove the balconies, you're going to be so concerned about the idea of falling that it will make you fall.
Yep.
And that's where the superpower is in removing the fear.
Yes.
So again, as a fan of the Joe Rogan podcast and obviously being a fan of Kanye, it's great to see him on the show, right? I love it. It's amazing. But it's just funny to see Joe fawning over Kanye West, especially considering the amount of times he's bashed mostly Kim Kardashian, Kanye's wife, over time. He's obviously said some, maybe he's kind of painted Kanye to be crazy when he was acting crazy. But it's interesting to see how different Joe is whenever the person's in front of him. He always seems to calibrate his energy based on the person that comes in front and how they basically vibe, which you can understand in it. He's not going to go out and start, you know, calling Kim Kardashian's bum fake in front of her fucking husband. Do you know what I mean? I can definitely understand that. But it's just funny to see that happen. But again, interesting enough interview. I think if you haven't consumed any Kanye content lately, it's probably the best one to consume because he's talking to an actual normal human that isn't sucking him up as much as others would have if they sat down with him. Like, if you're looking for somebody to push him back on some of his topics, the only way I saw Joe really challenging Kanye was on some of his policies for this, you know, for the supposed presidential run that he's kind of running on, and he kind of came up a bit short. That was the only part of the interview where Kanye kind of had to pause a few moments and gather his thoughts and really think about what he was saying. Most of the times he was freewheeling on the topics that he knows and he could speak about quite eloquently. But when it came to politics, he had a lot of kind of, you know, a lot of excuses as to why he couldn't speak on certain things. So I guess he might not be the right person to vote for in the ballots. But again, you know, why not throw his name on there if you're that way inclined? You know, it's not really my place to say, really. I'm not over there. But again, pretty decent interview, I think, for the most part. Echoing on and continuing, last topic of the day, and we move on. In more Kanye-related news, Kim Kardashian celebrated her 40th birthday the other day, and I think I made some snarky joke about it on Instagram about, you know, just being annoyed seeing all these random people who aren't celebrities wishing her happy birthday, don't know her personally. To me personally, wishing somebody you don't know who happens to be a celebrity happy birthday is just as worse, if not on the same level as wishing yourself happy birthday. You know, people that do that on your social media feed who, you know, take a picture of a flute filled with champagne or Prosecco and then say happy birthday to me, or take a picture of themselves in an amazing outfit and say my birthday suit, right? Some people do a bit in a clever way. They don't say happy birthday to me, they say birthday suit. They say, oh, what do you call it? Thank God for blessing me for another year, whatever, some sort of phrase. And then you hear this, you just see choruses of people congratulating them on surviving another year, right? And it's just like, what the fuck is this? When did birthdays become such a public show of celebration? They always, in my opinion, were little private moments that you could sort of like toast yourself and say, wow, I survived. I hung on for another year. Here's to another year of prosperity. Here's to another year of struggling. Here's another year of still fighting, of working hard, whatever it may be. But it was more of a private toast between you and maybe a close group of family and friends. But this idea that you are celebrating in public with everybody as if it was some sort of achievement, as if it's something worthwhile to even share. You know, we all have birthdays, especially if you stay alive. It's not that big of a deal. And even if you pass, some people have birthdays still. They continue to celebrate their memory. But again, you know, in this era that we live in at the moment, where everyone's essentially their own personal reality TV show, it makes complete sense why people want to make such a minute and pretty much irrelevant occasion in their life something that can be broadcast all over the place to maybe elevate and kind of, you know, showcase their wealth and maybe their group of friends, blah de blah blah blah. So it's no surprise that somebody like a Kim Kardashian decided to tell the entire world that she was going to celebrate her 40th birthday on a private island with some of her closest and best friends. And it to say it wasn't received well on the social media is an understatement. Everyone's sort of kind of, you know, poking fun at it. Some people are getting really, really angry and really upset, which is really weird. She's a celebrity. She's rich beyond her wildest dreams. So is her entire family. I don't know what people expected her to do. What, stay at home, order pizza and watch Netflix? That's not happening. If she has the means and the possibilities to do so, she's gonna go out there and celebrate her birthday in the most epic way. And if anything as well, we should not be surprised, because in my experience, from what I've seen so far, the pandemic has probably widened the wealth inequality around the world. But the gap between the haves and the have-nots have been really, really magnified during COVID, right? If you're able to basically weather the storm of not being able to sell, provide services or make any kind of money during COVID, right, it's really gonna, well, if you're able to survive this period, it definitely shows where you fall in terms of like the wealth ladder, right? How far up and down you are. And if you're really struggling and you have to turn up to work and go work in a McDonald's drive-thru or some other lowly service industry job, it definitely shows where you are too. So I'm assuming you wouldn't be surprised when you see someone like Kim Kardashian deciding to fly half her family out to a flipping private island somewhere to celebrate her birthday and get tested, you know, 24 hours before she heads out there. It's completely understandable, especially as well considering what's happening in the world. But anyway, the tweet itself that went viral was the following. It said, Kim Kardashian posts here, 40 and feeling so humbled and blessed. There is not a single day that I take for granted, especially during these times when we're all reminded of the things that truly matter, right? And I'm not, is that the one where she, and there's an image here of her and her family posing on the beach. Of course, having a hell of a time, her in her birthday suit looking absolutely impeccable. I'm pretty sure she makes sure she didn't have any carbs before this week because she looks really, really tight all over the place. So I make congratulations for that. The next following tweet from Kim is the following. It says, for my birthday this year, I couldn't think of a better way to spend it than with some of the people that who have helped and shaped and make me into the woman I am today. And that you've got some images, of course, with some, I guess, old school friends from back in the day, because they look a little bit, you know, normal, I'd say, right? They'd look less enhanced. And then the next image, we have some more enhanced friends or friends that look a bit more shiny, have that celebrity look towards them. And it continues. Let's go on the next one that's causing outrage. And she says, before COVID, I don't think any of us truly appreciate what a simple luxury it is to be able to travel and be able together with family and friends in a safe environment. Again, I love the refusal to read the room from people of wealth and notoriety. Why would you read the room if you can just go and book a holiday and a private jet somewhere to a private island and kind of insulate yourself from the hate of others? If you're rich, you keep on getting richer. So there's an image here again with someone, another shiny looking person who's definitely a new friend, another shining adult male, all looking good and fantastic. We continue on. So she says, after 2 weeks of multiple health screens and asking everyone to quarantine, I surprised my closest inner circle with a trip to a private island where we could pretend things were normal just for a brief moment in time, which, you know, if there ever was a representation of real privilege, this is it, right? It's interesting that she said this was a surprise event, considering that she asked her friends for 2 weeks to do multiple health screens and asked them to quarantine prior. I'm sure there's someone out there is going to be combing their social media feeds to find evidence of people who were gallivanting around town for the 2 weeks, within that 2 week window, So that's interesting. And if there is proof, photographic proof of the privilege, this is it, right? Look in the background of one of these pictures. Look at one of the servers there having to wear a mask. I'm sure the other people, yeah, I'm sure they probably did tests as well, but to be at this private island and having to wear a mask and serve some of the higher ups here, right? You got a little cherub boy here filling his cheeks with copious amounts of double cheeseburgers. It must be a real pain in the ass, isn't it? But what can you do? Next one, she said, we danced, rode bikes, swam near whales, kayaked and watched a movie on a beach and so much more. Yeah, I'm sure so much more. I realized that for most of us, this is something that is so far out of reach right now. So in moments like this, I'm humbled and reminded of how privileged my life is. So Kim had to get to her 30th birthday party on a private island to realize that she has a privileged life. The oblivious, there's something so admirable about being this obliviously rich. It just must be so great to wake up and just not have to worry about anyone apart from yourself and your family members under your roof, like genuinely not have a care in the world. It's admirable that she does what she does, you know, in terms of freeing people from prison, what's it called, prison reform that she's kind of spearheading, and you know, whatever other projects she does outside of it, and obviously running a tight household, having a big family. I think that's a good message to spread out there, the fact that she's in a committed relationship, family affair, but the ability to just, you know, just tap out and just go and do what you want must be so freeing. That's where the term fuck you money comes from, innit? Because this is basically it. This is fuck you. And again, it's also interesting because she's done a lot of good during COVID, right? Kim's kept her head down. She's been a loyal ride or die bitch with Kanye, who's been freaking out all over the place, talking openly about her abortions and all this sort of madness, right? And she's hanging there. She's been a real ride or die bitch, and she's got her own money. She can't ever say that she's there for the clout, because you know, some people would argue she's probably diminishing her star somewhat by being associated with Kanye. And then everyone will forget about all that stuff the moment they see these pictures, because they don't fit into their current narrative of what they wanted to do. But it's also probably the best idea for her to put the pictures out of herself and make this whole thread, because more likely than not, press would have gone out there, or paparazzi, or someone would have found footage of them partying, and it would have been worse. So to just get out in front and say, hey, I did have a party, I did do my thing, here are the images, you know, do it as you please, I think it's probably the best way to have gone about it. And then here is an image, finally, of the cake and whatever it may be, and finally to end it. And of course, people are not happy. You know, immediately the replies underneath this tweet right now with the face. It says, happy birthday. I hope someone got you an alphabet book as a gift so you can learn to read the room, which is a great one. It said, some people are posting images of mass graves with the tweet, which is flipping insane. Another one says, hi, pause. I know you're hurting right now and can't figure out how you're going to feed your family, but please enjoy these photos of my family expensive vacation. I know I'm lucky to be so fabulously wealthy, so I'll make mention of it to sound sympathetic. And again, it's like, it's really impossible to be rich. That's why I appreciate people who are rich, especially the ones that just don't speak and don't, you know, make themselves accountable to the world and just kind of live their lives, because it's very difficult to be that wealthy and also try and appear normal, right? And try and have some semblance of relatability. It's just impossible. There's no way you can do it, because your entire life is one big privilege cake and you're just eating it every single day, not gaining a pound, right? The moment you know, you can change your face 7 million times like Khloe Kardashian does. You can just change your entire appearance like a Kylie Jenner or Kendall. You can set up an entire empire of, you know, makeup and body improvement things and whatever, cosmetic goods, and just essentially provide, you know, a nest egg for generations to come. It's really difficult to appear somewhat normal, right? And somewhat... yeah, just somewhat normal and every day. It's hard. It's really difficult. And there's this other one, Kim, there, people are dying. This is humble, they're reminded. And there's this excellent picture that I'm going to actually get printed with Stop Getting COVID, which is definitely going to be a good one. This iconic picture of Paris Hilton partying somewhere with a vest that says Stop Being Poor, which is absolutely epic. And then we continue. Another one, that private island has staff. That staff has family, and you put them in jeopardy because you're waiting to pretend it was normal again, which is a bit of a stretch. I think if you're screening everybody and you're getting tests and you're basically making sure everyone that's going out there is negative. It's the same like what they're doing with the UFC, right? The people that are doing the catering at the UFC have families too. The people that are doing the catering for the footballers have families. But if they're able to limit the amount of exposure they have to outside world before they head off to the island, it should be pretty much okay. Again, is it a good use of resources and people's time? Probably not, but I'm assuming the people that are working, the staff, were probably well compensated. I'm sure they were tipping them pretty well. If they're not, they're cut fucking cunts, but I think they were. So I'm sure the staff and the waiters weren't really that aggrieved, right? Because they're able to put food in their table or food in the plate of the table of their family due to this one very special 40th birthday. Y'all had 2 weeks of multiple testing. Most can't get one done, Kim. People haven't hugged their parents since February. People have died. People have died in hospital alone. Nurses are using FaceTime so that patient can hear the words of comfort, hear how much they're there. The family member can just say goodbye while you jet off on vacation. Again, all valid points, but like I said, I just think it's going to fall on deaf ears if you have that kind of level of wealth and money and you truly believe birthdays are important. Because this, again, this is all our problem. This is what I thought. We've kind of glorified and, you know, put on the pulpit or put on some sort of pedestal, you know, gender reveals, engagement announcements, new job, promotion things. They all turn into these kind of weird social media celebration points, right? So it's no surprise that celebrities are also kind of capitalizing and jumping on that trend and deciding, no, it's my 40th, it's a big year for me, 40, whatever. I don't know what that means if you're a celebrity. It doesn't really matter, really, because you don't really age, right? You can always reverse the hands of time, you know, with copious amounts of cosmetic surgery and whatnot. But she wanted to celebrate her big birthday. And again, what did you expect? She's not going to be sitting at home ordering takeaway. It continues here. Kindly go fuck yourself. Martha Kelly. And this is a photo of Americans waiting in line for a food bank. It's a privilege not to have to do this. Perhaps a birthday post wishing everyone in America who is not you good health and safety and security. This time instead, tone deaf much. That's very true, innit? She could have got a lot of points doing that, innit? Just a picture of her and her family, like, you know, staying indoors and running everyone to stay safe and vote. That would have been great, innit? That would have been such a killer. But again, everyone's allowed to do what they want to do. Holy night, a bomb there. Someone says, here, Kim, America humbly ask you to keep yourself and your humbleness and your husband on a private island with no sex until the end of time. Oh, people are mad. When my dad died of COVID, oof, I couldn't even see him at hospital. The only time I did is at a funeral, 250 people dead, millions of people out of jobs, homelessness, evictions, food banks are an all-time high, and you have the nerve to post this. How about out of touch are you? Very much so, and there's a meme here, so I just want to say that you are a horrible, horrible person. Oh my God, man. Again, but nothing's ever going to change, innit? Nothing's ever going to change, really. These people have kind of told us consistently who they are and showed us who they are. So I don't know if people are surprised. Like, choose your idols and choose your heroes carefully. And again, most of this wealth has come through the hands and through the eyeballs of people constantly tuning into the stuff that they produce, buying into the stuff that they put out there. So you can only blame yourself, innit, when they turn back and essentially spit in your face. But again, I could give less of a shit. That's to be expected. When you have fuck your money, you're gonna do fuck you stuff. She's Kim Kardashian West. What else did you expect her to do? Anyway, this is Jackson Dingo Show, episode number 394, I think that was. Thanks so much for tuning in as per usual. I'm going to head out now. If it's your first time listening, of course, make sure you smash that like button, hit subscribe, leave me a comment down below. If you're listening via the podcast app, please leave me a 5-star review and share the show to your friends. And of course, I'll see you guys again very, very soon. Until then, take care. Peace.